You may be seated. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. It's not an easy time when we're brought together for such an occasion as this, but we all must remember. We must remember that it is in God's providence, that Jacob Korevaar has been taken away. The Bible says that there's a time to be born, and there is also a time to die. This was Jacob's time. This was God's timing for Jacob. He lived his life. All we have now are memories. All we are to do now is to cherish the memories as best we could. Jacob has left this scene of time. His body is here, yes, but his soul has departed to his maker. Jacob is with the Lord, and to our comfort as well, Jacob is also with Marie. I've known Jacob for 14 years, and he was loved by everyone. And Jacob was a faithful man, a man that can quote scripture. He knew the scriptures, a man that knew where he was going when he would pass this scene of time, a man that knew the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal savior. Because there was a time in his life, I don't know what that time was, when he turned his life over to the Lord Jesus Christ. He trusted and believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. A man that died believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. On behalf of the Korevaar family, we welcome everyone today to this memorial service of Jacob Korevaar. And some, I understand, have traveled from a far distance, and we thank you for coming and especially for supporting the family. We also welcome those that have joined us through internet. We thank you for joining us at this memorial service. Our prayers are for you. Our prayers are for you, and especially for the family. And we trust the Lord. The Lord would make himself known to many of you, and that the Lord will certainly draw near to every family member. Let's bow in prayer. Our gracious Father in heaven, we do rejoice for the hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank thee for the Lord Jesus Christ, who did come to this sin-cursed world bring about such a great salvation. We do rejoice that he lived that perfect life for us. And we thank thee, our Father, that he died, shed his blood, that we may go free. And our Father, we do rejoice especially because the promises of God are yea and amen in Jesus Christ. We thank thee for the promises that thou hast given to thy people, that after this scene of time, that they will be with the Lord forever. And our Father, we know that we cannot see these things, but yet, our Father, thou hast told us that we're not to live by sight, but we're to live by faith. We believe the word of God. And our Father, we pray that thou would work this afternoon, especially in the hearts of those that are struggling at this time. And we ask of thee that thou would truly minister to every heart, that we may know that God is, and that God is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Be with us, we pray, for we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn, Abide With Me, and we're all going to stand as we sing, those of you that can, and we're going to sing Abide With Me. Let us stand. All together.
Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, where that nature bride is stood to deliver. Abide with me. joys grow dim, its glories pass away. Change and decay in all around I see. Thou who changest not, abide with me. But a brief glance I beg, a passing word, that of the to sojourn, but abide with me. Come not in terrors as the King of Kings, but kind and good with healing in thy come, friend of sinners, and thus bide with me. Thou on my head in early youth did smile, until I left thee. On to the close, O Lord, abide with me. I need thy presence every dancing hour, but can foil the temper's power. Who like thyself my guide and stay can be? Though cloud and sunshine, Lord, abide with me. With thee at hand to bless, I'll have no weight and tears, no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still if thou abide with me. Hold thou thy cross, and as thy thrills my eyes, shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's vain shadows flee. In life in death, O Lord, abide with me.
You may be seated. I'm going to read from Psalm number 90 this morning. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to it. Psalm number 90. And we're going to commence our reading from verse number 1. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and sayest, Return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood, they are as a sleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up, in the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength and labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? And let it repent thee concerning thy servants. O satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Let thy work appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands, establish thou it. We'll end our reading there, trusting the Lord will add his blessing to his own infallible and errant and inspired word. Death is a real part of life. We all live with that constant awareness of our own mortality, as well as the mortality of those that are around us. Without a doubt, the most difficult trial and pain we must all bear in life is the pain of losing someone that we love so dearly in death. There is nothing, absolutely nothing harder to do than to walk by a casket of a husband, or a casket of a wife, or a child, or a parent, or a brother or sister, and say goodbye. Goodbye to their earthly time here on earth, knowing that you'll never see them again for the rest of your life. There is a loneliness there, and there is also emptiness, sadness, that follows the death of a loved one, is sometimes almost, well, in many cases, unbearable. The sorrow can be manifested in so many different ways. People do grieve in different, various ways. For some, the very mention of the name, the person will begin to cry. For some, they don't even want to mention the name any longer. In fact, they want to forget the person ever existed, because it brings pain. It hurts. The heart hurts. Some weep, and some are accepting. But all of us will certainly at some time face the hurt of having death take from us someone that we love. And ever since the beginning of time, when God made Adam and Eve, when Adam and Eve rebelled against God, that's where death has come in to human life. Death has been a horrible reality of the human experience. Suffering and pain and death is all because of man sinning against God. It wasn't God's intention to be this way, but it was because of man's sin that he destroyed himself when he disobeyed the word of God. And so today we are reminded again. We are reminded again of death and the reality of death. And I think that my most difficult job as a pastor, the job of what to say. What to say to those that are bereaved. I think the most difficult part for me is knowing what to say to be of a comfort. And I think the most difficult part is knowing what to say to encourage the people that have lost loved ones and are bereaved. Well, it seems that there is nothing. It seems that there is nothing I can really say that can take away the pain. And sometimes I feel like, well, the things that I say, well, are wrong. They're not the right things to say, or at least it may be wrong. Funerals never get easier. They don't get easy. I never get used to funerals. In fact, well, I don't want to be here. I don't want to participate in funerals because, well, I know there's a lot of hurting people, people that are hurting much. However, death is such an unavoidable and universal reality because the Bible says it is appointed. It is appointed to man to die. Our life here on earth is temporary. However, you need to know today that the Lord Jesus Christ has conquered death. He has come and he's conquered death. And so we do need to realize that is the good news. That is the good news that's being proclaimed. That's the good news that we have concerning the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't have to mourn as if there is no hope, because there is hope. There is hope in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Psalm 90. Psalm 90 is a prayer of Moses, and it was written a long time ago. Well, they tell us that it was written 3,500 years ago, and it's dealing with the same old issues here because of sin. Because of sin. Well, they were dealing with the issue of death. And in Psalm 90, there was a sentence of death upon this whole generation. Instead of the conquest of Canaan, there would be woe in the wilderness. And we see that because verse 3, it does tell us there in verse 3, "Thou turnest man to destruction, and says, Return, ye children of men." And also in verse 7, "For we are consumed by thine anger." That's because of sin. "And by thy wrath are we troubled." And so these Israelites moved from place to place, leaving behind them desert graves. As they passed through the area, they would leave these bodies in graves. And for 40 years they wandered. And during this time, every man and woman of the old generation, they passed away. It was the sentence of death upon them because of the Lord's anger against them. And so Moses, the man of God, as he contemplates this period of time with the thoughts of the years passing swiftly, he writes this 90th psalm, the oldest psalm there is. He writes this psalm, and it was at this time that we understand that the period of man's life even became shorter, because he does tell us there, to the present standards, because he does tell us there in verse number 10, Moses says in verse number 10, "The days of our years are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, that's like 70, 80 years old, yet in their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away." I want you to notice those words, "for it is soon cut off and we fly away." Just a couple of points this afternoon which I want to mention that Moses realized. And the first thing he realized here was very simply the brevity of life. Verse 10, it says, "For it is soon cut off." He's talking here about human life. for it is soon cut off. And also in verse number 12, to number our days, he says, to number our days. And also in verse 9, for all our days are passed away in thy wrath. And then in verse 10, days of our years. And this term here implies that life here on earth has a limit. It has a limit here. No one lives on earth forever. And the words day here, the word days, well, it would give us the impression that life is very short. Why? Because it does not associate our mortal lives with centuries or years. It says here, days. Life is measured by days. On account of sin, the whole adult nation lived at that time on death row. There was no guarantee that they would see another day. Things have not changed. Things have not changed, for we also have no guarantee of tomorrow. The Bible says, who knows what a day may bring forth? And who knows? Who knows what a day may bring forth? The whole world, bears evidence of being under a curse because of sin. Storms and tempests and earthquakes, well, pestilences. We're living in a time of pestilences. There's diseases of every kind, and death, with all its pains, with all its horrors, are the sad fruits of sin. Death has obtained a universal empire. A universal empire. It reigns over the earth. It reigns over the earth. Evidence is found everywhere. Moses says concerning human life, for it is soon cut off. And then in verses 5 and 6, he also mentions there, verses 5 and 6, thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass, which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. That was his estimation of life, the duration of life, the brevity of life. Well, we can go to the New Testament, and I'm sure you all know James, what he wrote. Well, he gave his own description. He gave his own description concerning the brevity of human life, and he starts by asking a question. And the question is there in James 4, verse 14, for what is your life? Well, what is your life? What is my life? For what is your life? And then he answers it himself. And he answers and says, it is even a vapor. It is even a vapor that appeareth for a time and then vanisheth away. What's he doing here? Well, he compares the natural human life with a vapor, which appears for a time and then it disappears. Well, we all know what a vapor is from a kettle. I'm sure we have made ourselves something hot at some time, and we know what a vapor from a kettle spout is like. Well, a vapor is almost nothing. It's almost nothing. In a moment, it's gone. And that is God's picture, you see, of man's duration upon the earth. For, Moses says, it is soon. For it is soon cut off. You see, when you compare our days here on earth with the duration of eternity, well, it is a vapor indeed. And if this is the case, then I'm not wrong. I'm not wrong in saying this afternoon that soon we will all find ourselves in eternity. Very soon we will find ourselves in eternity. Soon we ourselves will be in eternity. And so we will leave this scene of time and we will find ourselves in eternity. So Moses not only realized the brevity of life here on earth, but he noticed there's something else I want you to notice, and that is that he realized that man has a soul. Well, you say, well, where do you get that from? Well, if you look at those words, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. What's he talking about there? Well, he's talking about the soul, and we fly away. There's an exit of the soul from the body. It makes an exit. And so the soul really never dies. The soul never dies. A death comes when the soul departs from the body. A physical death involves the departing of body and soul. Now, there's a very controversial question in biomedical ethics, is the question concerning what death is and when death occurs. And the answer is that death, we're talking here about physical death, occurs the moment a person's soul exits the body. That's when death occurs, you see, when the person's soul exits from the body. And Scripture tells us that at death, man giveth up the ghost. He giveth up the ghost, he expires, he breathes out his last breath. And so what happens? Okay, leaves the body. So what happens here? Well, where can we get this information from? Because we certainly don't want to make a mistake in this matter. Who do we believe? Who is it that we believe? Do we believe man? Do we really think man has the answers? Do we believe in man-made religions? And to go even further, do we believe in our own hearts, what our opinions are concerning what takes place? Well, if you go to the scientists and you go to the philosophers, they will most likely tell you that man dies and that's it. That's it. Nothing left. Gone into absolute nothingness. Job, he asked the question in Job 14, verse 14, and he says, if a man die, shall he live again? If a man die, shall he live again? Well, again, the Bible alone, God's revelation alone can tell us what takes place. Does that soul live? And only the Bible can tell us the truth in this matter. It alone can tell us the answer. Where does the soul go? Where does the soul go? Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7, then the dust shall return unto the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. And so, to be very simple, man dies, man has a soul, it departs from him, it goes to his maker. Well, then shall the dust return the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. And so immediately here after death, the soul appears before God. Now, whether you want to believe this or not, this is what the Scriptures teach. And that is not the end, because, well, you're not only before God, but now you're going to be consigned to a place. You're going to be consigned to a place. And again, where do we get the answers to all this? Well, again, Scripture gives the answer, and Scripture only speaks of two places. There's only two places here, and I have to be faithful in preaching this, because there's a heaven, yes, but there's also a hell, a place of misery. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 28, this is what the Lord Jesus Christ says. This is not what I said. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew 10, verse 28. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ says. So the Bible talks about a hell, a place of misery for all those that have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ, unbelievers. The Bible in the New Testament records the story of a man who died, and this man entered into hell. And this man here was a rejecter of the Lord Jesus, and this is what he experienced there in Luke chapter 16, immediately after, well, not even 5 minutes after he left the scene of time. And this is what he experienced, because in Luke 16 and verse number 22, it says, and it came to pass that the beggar died, and there was carried by the angels unto Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and says, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in torment in this flame. This is what the Bible teaches. This is what the Bible says concerning this place that souls that have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ that are assigned to. And so where is the rich man? Where is this rich man, the one who, not because he was rich, but because he rejected the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, yes, he died 2,000 years ago, perhaps even longer. His body has disappeared in the dust, right? Of course it did. It's no longer here upon the earth. It disappeared as dust, but his soul which is eternal, it lives on forever in misery. Now, I have to be faithful in this because this is what the Bible teaches. And he died without getting right with God, without making peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. So that is one place. But there's another place. There's another place because Scripture tells of another place for those that have believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's a place called heaven. And this is a reality. Because these are the only two places for the departed soul. It's come before God. Now God's going to consign these souls, which direction they're going to take. Now, when I stand with a grieving family over the casket of a believer, in the Lord Jesus Christ, the believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, it is a comfort to know that he or she lives on in the very presence of God in heaven. It's a great comfort to know that. Do you know for sure where your eternal home will be? Do you know for sure? The Bible says, blessed are they that die in the Lord. You say, how could there be blessing in dying? The Bible says, blessed are they that die in the Lord. Why? Because there's a soul, and the soul lives on. And that soul will live on throughout eternity with the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the Bible speak for itself. This is what the Bible says. In John 14, the Lord Jesus, which you cannot lie, he is God. And he says here, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ says. I never said this. This is what the Bible teaches. This is what we're to preach. And Revelation 14, verse 13, again, let the Bible speak. Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. Again. Blessed are they that die in the Lord, or blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. And then another New Testament verse we have in 2 Corinthians 5 and verses 6, it says, therefore, we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. This is the Christian hope. This is the hope that we have as believers. This is the hope, the only hope of mankind. Then we have the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you know your Bibles, remember the Lord Jesus, he died, had one thief on one side, the other thief on the other side, and one of the thieves repented. He believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord and this thief, they were minutes away from dying. Minutes away from dying. And the Lord Jesus says to him in Luke 23, verse 43, he says, today. He thought, the thief thought, just remember me. But the Lord says, no, I don't have to remember you because it's today. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. It's going to be today. Before that sun goes down, you will be with me in paradise. They took the thief off the cross, and they buried his body, whatever they did to his body, and it was taken down from the cross and buried. But again, we're talking about the soul. The soul would be with Christ in paradise. I'm not talking about the body. The body was taken down from the cross, buried and so forth, but the soul, thou shalt be with me in paradise. And so the soul would be with paradise that very same day. And so where is he today? Again, where is he today? His body's, you'll never find his body. It's come to dust. But his soul is with Christ in paradise. And the Bible makes it very clear that after death, there is an existence for our mortal souls. Our brother Jacob, yes, he gave up the ghost. He gave up his soul. He's no longer with us. And if the inquiry is made, where is he? Where is Jacob? And the answer would be, he is happy forever with the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, which the Bible says is far better. And I can tell you that if you ask him, Jacob, do you want to go back to the earth? I will tell you now that he says, no way. He would want to come back to this earth. He is in a far better place, the place with the Lord Jesus. John 5, verse 24, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Nobody's perfect. Of course, nobody's perfect. Jacob, I'm not saying Jacob was perfect. And I'm not even saying that anything else about it, because he always used to talk about the apple cider and vinegar. That was his solution for everything. Well, we're not talking about that, but we're talking about his soul passing into eternity. And there's no apple cider vinegar there in heaven. Well, at least we don't know. We don't know. Maybe, I don't know, maybe he has a shop there with apple cider vinegar, but I don't think so. John chapter 5, verse 24, verily, verily, that is truly, truly. You have to believe this. This is what the Lord Jesus says. Truly, truly, I say unto you, that if you hear my words and believe on him that sent me, hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. And so, as we face death, whether it be our own death or the death of our, well, of a loved one, we can face it victoriously. We can face it victoriously because of our confidence there in the Lord Jesus Christ, who triumphed over death. He triumphed over hell. He triumphed over the grave. And this is why it is very important that one puts their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. When you know the Lord Jesus, the Lord of life, the Lord of death, you face even death. Even death, you face it with might, and you face it with strength, and you face it with power. Without the Lord Jesus, you face death with absolutely no hope. I have to be faithful in this. There's no hope. There's no hope to die, and there's no sadder sight on earth than to watch a dying man or a dying woman approach a Christless eternity. Yet for the Christian, there is victory of a conquered death. The Apostle Paul, he cries out, I'll end it with this, O death, he says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And again, we're all going to a world where everything is eternal. Every one of us is going there. And, well, you need to be wise. We would be very wise to give consideration to these facts. This is what God has chosen. God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. To prepare for eternity and to seek to be found in Christ and having his righteousness. May God give us that grace to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. For we will need a priest as we come before God, and we'll be able to point to our high priest, and we're able to say, Jesus paid it all to him we owe. May God bless his word. Let's bow in prayer. Our gracious Father in heaven, we do rejoice for the scriptures of truth. We thank thee that we're able to encourage ourselves in the word of God. We thank thee, our Father, that is none other than the word of the living God, the God-breathed word. And our Father, we come to thee acknowledging that thou art God. We thank thee, our Father, that thou knowest each person here present. Thou knowest our thoughts. And our Father, we would ask of thee that thou would work in every heart, that we, when we leave this scene of time, that we will be found in Christ, and we will be found in that place which is heaven itself. Be with us, for we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing another hymn. Great is thy faithfulness, found there in the pamphlet. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Let's stand and sing, Great is thy faithfulness.
Is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, good unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, thy mercies I see. All that I've needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
You may be seated. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. I'm going to call our brother John Cooper. He's going to bring us some announcements and a few other details.
It's my distinct privilege to deliver a eulogy for Dad on behalf of the family. Our sincere thanks to all those who expressed their sympathy and to those who are viewing the service across Canada, Holland, South Africa, Bahamas, and Ireland. 70 years ago, on April the 15th, A young man of 18 years with $200 in his pocket arrived in Canada. That man was Jacob Korevaar. Some 7 years later, he married a wonderful lady, Helena Marie Fintelman. Today, as Dad would say, there are 63 head in the immediate family, including the newest addition, Dawson, the firstborn of Emily and Tyler on Tuesday of this week. Dad's walk was not always easy, but he had an innate ability to keep putting one foot in front of the other. The result is that all of us are the beneficiaries of his decision so many years ago to immigrate to Canada. Dad's welcome speech when Evelyn and I were married contained some advice that is as good today as it was then. Treasure the ones you love and humor those that are not as lovely. To the family at large, Dad said, remember each other for good. Although sometimes it might seem like you're between a rock and a hard place, my advice, reward not evil for evil. I arrived a little late to the family, you might say, and on meeting Dad for the first time, he called me a city slicker. Now, knowing Dad was a farmer, it really didn't bother me too much. Dad and I built a bond together that I treasure. He shared many of his childhood experiences, some that undoubtedly shaped the man. As a young boy of 10 or 12 years old, during World War II, while in Holland, it was occupied by enemy soldiers, he and friends took refuge under a bridge to avoid stray bullets. And falling asleep, only to awaken in the morning to find the fellow next to him, dead with a bullet wound to the head. Having a gun put to his head and being asked to tell where the family's only pig was, so the troops had food to eat, and maybe a little more lighthearted, using discarded grenades to fish with in the canal. But Dad knew how to work. If it needed to be done or fixed, he did not stop until it was completed. If you ever watched or worked with him, he was a machine. If you worked for him, as the siblings will attest, the expectations were high, and he had no tolerance for goofing off. Now, the grandkids will tell you that he was an expert at patching or making things out of tin, and there were countless examples of that around the house. They'll remind you that when sitting at the dinner table waiting for Oma to dish out the food, Opa had a way of holding the knife between his fingers and tapping his plate while singing a song in Dutch. This caused the grandkids to get carried away, banging on their plates while Oma would try and bring order to that group of amateur musicians, worried that they would break the plates. They were laughing the other day about riding scooters down the driveway onto the road or putting younger cousins on a two-wheel dolly and racing it down the apartment hallways. They told of stories of Opa giving them rides on the two-wheel dolly, of swinging on the backyard swing, playing in a playhouse that he built, or using doll beds that he'd made for them. I believe I'm correct in saying that Dad built a chicken coop for every family. We just renovated ours, and he followed the process as late as last week, asking if we had our chickens yet. He was a loved opa. Tony stole my thunder, but Dad had a lot of home remedies, and apple cider vinegar apparently cured everything. He was the most accurate weatherman. If you were planning anything, you would be advised to ask what the forecast was, and he was pretty much right on. He could also regale you with weather patterns from years ago. He was a prolific reader right up until the end. He kept up with world affairs and studied biblical prophecy, and he could bring the two together in the simplest of terms. If you're not Dutch, you're not much. How often did we hear that? I once saw a shirt that said, "I'm not perfect, but I am Dutch," and that's about the same, and thought about getting it for him. The last couple of years were tough on Dad as Parkinson's took its hold on his body. He had difficulty walking, yet he insisted on navigating those basement stairs. That was where he and Oma sat, enjoying the fireplace, catching up on the day. You will know that Dad was not one to talk much. Oma, on the other hand, could talk to anyone, and she did. So each night she filled him in on all the news. In Mum's last days, she was worried about who would look after Dad, who would bring Dad food. Now she didn't need to worry, as Dad was pretty good at getting what he wanted. Dutch cheese, yogurt, and cinnamon raisin bread were always in the fridge. And whoever was visiting knew to bring a Tim's coffee with milk. And when he went to hospital, he was also very good at ordering Skip the Dishes breakfast service from Andrew. We want to recognize Lisa Ganame, she's here with us today, who cared for Dad at the retirement home. Dad listened to Lisa. He knew her shift patterns. He looked forward to seeing her, and he settled in there in large part due to his care, or her care, I should say, for him. And we want to thank you, Lisa, for that. In his final hours, Evelyn and I had the opportunity to spend time with Dad while he was still lucid. We, of course, told him we loved him, asked him if he would like us to pray with him, and he said yes. After praying, I spoke to Dad about where he was going. Heaven was his home, and tears began to roll down his cheeks. And he said, "Even the vilest sinner can know sins forgiven and have a home in heaven." I responded by saying Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And we quoted that verse, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him hath everlasting life." What a joyous reunion in heaven when Dad saw Mom again and when he met his Lord and Savior. I have a few announcements to make. First of all, I want to thank you all on behalf of the family for attending the memorial service here today. Immediately following this service, there's a reception in the gymnasium, and all are invited to come and have lunch with us. We'd like to, and I should point out, there's lots of space there for anybody that might be concerned about social distancing. We'd like to thank Heritage Baptist Church for allowing us to use the facilities here, and for the ladies of the church that did all that work in setting up and preparing to serve. There's a Christian school here in the building, and rather than walking through the hallway and disturbing the classrooms, when we exit the building out the front doors that you came, walk down the hill, and there's a set of double doors facing the road that will be open, and that's where the reception is. Now, if you have trouble with stairs or you have trouble with the hill, just let us know, and there is an elevator that you can use. Those of you who would be attending the burial or the cemetery, make sure you bring your program with you, please. When we exit the church parking lot, we're going to go right. We get to Highway 27, which is the stoplights. We turn right, and we go to Cookstown, where there is a set of stoplights, the only one in Cookstown. And you're going to turn left. And the cemetery is right across the road from the home that Mom and Dad shared. Now, just before we continue, I'm going to take the opportunity to give thanks for the lunch, so that when we go down there, you'll be able to grab butter tarts and things like that. Our God and Father, once again, we would come before you and we would thank you for the day that you've given to us. We thank thee for the remembrance of Dad. We thank thee for all that he means to each and every one of us here. We thank thee for the message that Pastor Tony has given, and we would ask that some of what has been said would stay with us, that it would be implanted in our heart. And oh, how wonderful it would be if some would come to the Lord Jesus today for salvation. We pray for safety as we continue through the rest of the day, thank you again for this facility here at Heritage Baptist Church, for all the folks that have been so kind and generous with their time. And we ask it all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.